she's our last speaker. I didn't see it, but I know she was trying to do the demo earlier yesterday to get it to somewhere, because they're very hands-on Smithsonian. So she's going to talk to us about alien worlds in the sense of exoplanets. We had a talk yesterday about occultations of asteroids, by asteroids of stars. This is going to be something a lot further away and a lot larger, but I hope equally interesting. So thank you very much, Genevieve.
Thank you, Alan. And thank you, everyone here. So this is a very exciting time to be giving this talk, because this is a very exciting year for exoplanets, for the hunt for planets around other stars. This year has marked not only a crowning achievement in the search for planets around other stars, but also a really important anniversary. So that's part of what I'll be talking about here. I'll show this cool little animation here. And so this is an artist's concept of an exoplanet that I'll be talking about more later. So thank you for the introduction, Alan, and thank you so much, all of you, for having me here and for being the diehards who stayed this long. It's really my honor to close out the Almost Heavens Star Party presentation component, although I'm crossing my fingers that this is not the end of the Star Party yet and that we'll get another great night of observing in. So I took this last night, and I'm enjoying the clear skies here. And it's this is my first time at a multi-night star party, and I am having a blast. And of course, I expect that every star party that I go to from now on will have this much clear skies. So really realistic expectations that I have. Thank you very much for having me. So what is an exoplanet? Loosely speaking, it's an exoplanet or an extrasolar planet. It's a planet that orbits a star other than the sun. Now, as was brought up earlier this weekend, the actual definition of a planet is a little bit hairy. excuse me. The actual definition of a planet says that a planet must orbit the sun. So a planet around another star is not technically, by the IAU definition, a planet. Which there are planets out there, and that's what we'll be talking about. So this is not a formal definition. As far as I know, there is no official definition of what an exoplanet is, although the IAU had sort of a draft definition that whatever counts as a planet around the sun, the same applies around other stars. So what we have here is... What was that? Right, yes. That might be a little confusing, but we could try it. So it's a little hard to see the background here. So what we have here is a painting done around 1950 by Chesley Bonestell, who did a marvelous work popularizing some of the recent advances in astronomy. He did a lot of magazine covers, things like that. This is a painting called Mira Ceti about the binary star Mira, which is a white dwarf, a very hot cinder of a star, like the leftover core of a star after the outer layer is puffed away. And all of this back here is a red giant, a bloated red giant that's in orbit around it. So those are two stars, two kinds of stars. And what he did not know when he did this is that this star is actually giving some gas to that one. So what we know now is that there's a tail of gas being stripped off the bloated red giant onto the small, hot white dwarf.
It's hidden by the mountain.
What was that?
It's hidden by the mountain.
What is?
The tail.
Right, yeah. Very convenient, right? So this view from a hypothetical exoplanet around Mira was plausible by the standards of what he knew then. And now we know that the view would be even more exciting and probably very hazardous to the health of whoever was on this hypothetical planet. This painting is in the collection of the Air and Space Museum. So the first exoplanets were found in 1992, although another one was found in the same system in 1994, and they are weird. So this is the first time that a planet was ever found around another star, but this star was a pulsar, a dead star, one kind of a dead star. So a neutron star is one way that a massive star can end its life. It is a small, very dense form of matter where a neutron star is typically about the size of Manhattan, but it has all the mass of a star. It is an extremely dense form of matter, and a pulsar has a strong magnetic field and jets shooting out of its axes. So this is a high radiation environment. And those jets sort of act like clocks. As they sweep across the Earth, we can get clicks of radio signal from the pulsar at extremely regular signals, which is how the planets were found around this pulsar, because slight variations in that timing help us find planets with high accuracy. So this would be a very weird environment for a planet, because this star would have died in a supernova, a massive explosion, which probably would have stripped away the atmosphere of these planets and probably rendered them unsuitable for life if they were suitable for life ahead of time. And now they're being baked by radiation from their corpse star, the pulsar. So this is a very weird and hostile environment, but it is where the first planets were found. As it turns out, this seems to be quite rare. Not many exoplanets have been found in this kind of environment. But that was the very first one, three planets in this system. Most of what you see here will be artist depictions. We have very few images that I'll be showing you. But they are as realistic as I can show. So many people don't credit that as the beginning of the exoplanet era because they're such weird exoplanets. Many people say that exoplanets started in 1995, which I'll get to in just a moment. And the planets that we found around the pulsar and the ones in 1995 were found with the radial velocity method, which is also called the Doppler method. So to demonstrate how this works, I need a volunteer. I was wondering if would you help me out? Okay. So I am the star, and you are the planet. We're going to do it right in the space. To be a little careful of the demo here, so just going to watch out for that. Hold my hands if you would. Okay, so as we're orbiting each other, so hold your arms out if you would a little bit more. So you're smaller than me, so you're moving further, right? So those of you in the audience watching are seeing her move a lot and me move just a little bit, right? Now, you get a superpower now. You're invisible. Yay. So you can't see her, but you can see me. And you can see I'm wobbling a little bit, right? Now, maybe you can measure that if I'm actually a star far away. Thank you. That was great. So maybe you can measure my wobble side to side if you had very precise instruments, but that's hard, measuring the motion of a star in the sky like that because they're so far away. They're just tiny points of light. But there's another kind of motion. My wobble here was side to side, but it was also backward and forward. So when I'm coming toward you and going away from you, that is changing in a regular way. And this is showing how we can use the spectrum of a star to detect that wobble in the star's motion. If we divide up the star's light into its colors, we get the rainbow of the star, or its fingerprint, its spectrum, which often has lines of color in it that can help us determine what a star is made of. But okay, so here's a star, here's a planet exaggerated in size. And as they orbit each other, you see that the star is wobbling less than the planet. But it is moving, and when it's moving toward us, the lines go toward the blue. That's blue shifted. And when it goes away from us, they go toward the red. I'm going to play that again so you can get another look. So by watching that regular shift in the colors of the star, you can detect that it has an unseen companion, the planet. So now it's going to start coming toward us. So they're going blue. And now it's starting to go away from us, so it's more red. And it shifts back and forth regularly. That's called the radial velocity method or the Doppler method because it's showing the star's motion toward and away from you, like radially toward or away from you. And that shifting is called the Doppler shift. So that very precise motion can help you find a planet around the star. What kind of planet would be easiest to find with this method, do you think? What characteristics would that planet have? Heavy, right? So a large mass planet. Because you can imagine if we were similar sizes, then the wobble would be greater. And in fact, many stars do have companion stars, and we can see them moving the same way. So the bigger the planet, the more wobble it'll have on the star. Any other characteristics that would make it easy to find with this method? Short period, what do you mean by that? So close into the star, which means that it has a short year or short period. So it doesn't have very far to go around the star, and it's going fast. So the closer the planet is to the star, the faster it's going to make the star wobble, and the more it will make the star wobble. Whereas if it's far out, its gravitational influence on the star is not as great, and so the star will wobble less. So this method is good for finding large planets that are close to the star. What was
in
that?
In line with our sign.
Right, that's another great characteristic to point out. So if the star is here and the planet is going this way, well, the star's wobbling, but not toward or away from you. So you're not going to be able to see it's detected this way. So it doesn't have to be coming exactly toward and away from you, but at least somewhat. That's a really good point. So this is good for finding close-in massive planets. But if you look at our solar system, those don't exist, right? The closest massive planet we have to the stars, to our star, is Jupiter. And all of our close-in planets are small planets, which would be hard to find with this method. So astronomers thought those kinds of planets don't exist, so this was going to be a difficult search. And then in 1995, they found the first kind of planet like this. Around the star 51 Pegasi, 51 Pegasi b is what's called a hot Jupiter, a large planet, like roughly Jupiter size or larger, in a tight orbit around its star. It has a year measured in only days. It's much, much closer to its star than Mercury is to our sun.
Oh my
Lord. That's so weird, right? Having a really massive planet that close to the star. So this is the first planet that was found, and many people hail this as the beginning of the exoplanet era. This is the first exoplanet that was found. Although you could really say it started in 1992 when that planet was found around the pulsar. And I'm going to show here a song by the Chromatics. They are a music group composed of professional astronomers who write and perform songs about astronomy. So the science content that you hear in their songs is really good. And this one is written about the search for exoplanets. And you'll see a lot of content in this song, which is similar to what we're talking about already and which we'll talk about later in today's talk. So I will play it for you, and I'll scroll down the lyrics so you can see the rest. I love this song. Oops, sorry, my bad. Was written a while ago.
Thank you.
I just love that song. So, as you probably recognize some of the science she was talking about in that song from what we already discussed about the backward and forward motion, the companion of closest proximity, like a planet really close to the star, and about the planets around the pulsars. What are those like? They've been around for so long. So that was when planets were discovered around other stars. That's when, in 1995, is when we knew it was possible for there to be planets around regular stars, not just pulsars. Raise your hand if you were born before 1992. Yeah, right. So most of us in this room have experienced a time when we didn't know about planets around other stars. We had no idea what it would be like. Would they be like our solar system? Like, that's all we had to go on. Or would they be rare? Would there be planets like our Earth around stars like our sun? Maybe that could be friendly to life. So there was so much unknown at that time.
There were astronomical binaries that people thought existed, but then they really didn't.
Right, so there were some claims before, that's right. These 1992 was the first confirmed planet around a star, the pulsar. What was that?
These are proper motion measurements.
Right.
Where you're spinning the
right.
It's along what you're moving through space.
So mm-hmm. Right. So you can measure the back and forth. It is possible, but very difficult. So what does this mean? Like finding these planets around the stars. Any ideas? Like why do you care about this topic? It's cool. We might not be alone. Are we alone in the universe? Right. So it's a really exciting topic to me. And it was 20 years ago that the first planet around a regular star, as opposed to a stellar corpse, was found. 20 years ago, this October 6th. So 51 Pegasi b, or 51 Peg, as it often goes by for short, is an example of a hot Jupiter, a star, a planet very close to its star. Maybe not this close, this is a little silly, but it's just to show, these are planets that are extremely close to their stars, and they would be really hot. So they would have things like strong storms, like strong winds carrying material from their dayward side to their nightward side. Clearly not a very friendly place for life, but really interesting that they exist. And how do they get there? Astronomers are still arguing this. You'll recognize this theme a lot in this talk, astronomers arguing about it, being surprised by it, saying, this can't be, and then being proved wrong. That happens a lot in this field about exoplanets. So astronomers did not think it was possible for planets to form this close in. In fact, most astronomers still feel that way, that the planet can't have formed there that close to the star. It must have formed further out where it was cold enough for it to gather that much material. So if that is true, and I don't think we're taking anything on faith at this point about what isn't possible for exoplanets, but if it is true that the giant planets can't form this close to the star, how do they get there? They must have moved there. And in fact, that does make sense when you run some computer models for how planets might migrate around their solar system. In fact, a lot of astronomers are now thinking that our planets might have migrated around our solar system earlier in our solar system's history, changing their radii from the sun quite a lot, and maybe even ejecting a planet from our solar system. We might have had a ninth big planet in our solar system that was kicked out. That makes sense with computer models in our current solar system dynamics. It probably would have been something roughly Neptune size. And now it's out there all alone, if it really does exist. So also, when those planets migrate, if they migrate inward like this, why would they migrate so close inward to their star and then stop and not fall into the star? And also, what happens to the, what was that?
So they have
regular circular orbits, very stable, but they're whipping around their star in just a few days, which is a lot faster than our own sun even rotates. So also, what would happen to the other planets in that solar system? Can you imagine what would happen if something larger than Jupiter migrated inward through the orbits until it was very close to the sun? Havoc for the other planets, right? And in fact, hot Jupiters do tend to be relatively alone. There don't tend to be very many other planets in those solar systems. So maybe it ejects them or destroys them, causes them to fall into their star, something like that. This is a very active field of research. We don't really know what these hot Jupiters are doing so close to their stars, but there are a lot of them, and the radial method is good for finding them. The first time the atmosphere of a planet was detected was in 2001. This planet with the lovely name of HD209458b, unofficially called OSIRIS. This is a very interesting planet because this is an exoplanet with a lot of firsts. It was the first planet whose atmosphere was detected. And the way that you detect an atmosphere for a planet is if this is the star and this is the exoplanet, when it comes around, when the planet comes between you and the star, if it does, then the light from the star can shine through the atmosphere of the planet. It's like you're seeing all the sunrises and sunsets on that planet at once, and then come on its way to you. Now, you can't resolve this picture. The stars are too far away. But you are getting the light of the star, which you can divide into a spectrum, like a fingerprint. And you can, when this comes around in front of the star, the elements in the atmosphere of that planet can put a slight imprint on the spectrum of the star. This is a very difficult measurement because it's a very it's very small compared to the overall light from the star. But it is measurable, and this planet, OSIRIS, is the first one where that was detected. You can also get other information when the planet goes behind the star to try to measure how hot the planet is. OSIRIS is also the first planet where molecules were detected in the atmosphere of a planet. And it was, I think, the first transiting planet to be found, the first planet to be found by the transit method, which is what we're going to cover next. Or actually, I'm going to come back to that when I start talking about the Kepler spacecraft. So this was long before Kepler. The transit method was used to find quite a few planets, and OSIRIS is the first one that was found in 2001. And 2007 was the first time that water was detected on a planet around another star. Obviously, we're really interested in finding water around in an exoplanet because if where there's water, if it's liquid water and other conditions are right, maybe there could be life. Maybe there might be life where there's no water, but we don't know about that kind of life. So we might as well start by looking for water on these planets. So this planet, another name that rolls trippingly off the tongue, its atmosphere was confirmed to have water in it in 2007. And this is a hot planet. I can't remember if it's Jupiter size or a little bit smaller, but it's a pretty big planet, but not necessarily a giant planet. And it's hot. It's close to its star. So it does not have liquid water. But it does have water vapor in its atmosphere. So it has a steamy atmosphere. So that's possible. That's exciting. Then you can also find planets by just taking a picture of them. That is possible. So it is difficult. Some of you would have seen this this picture on Friday during Bob's talk. And so with this Hubble image, the star was blocked from view because it's so bright. All this scattered light here is coming from the star. And here you can see a dusty disk around the star, which has this interesting inner sharp edge. Why isn't it just sort of a smooth disk? Why does it have a sharp inner edge? Astronomers did suspect that there might be a planet here sort of shepherding the inside of that ring. And after some back and forth, they did confirm that, yes, there is a planet there, Fomalhaut B. So this is the first planet to be found with direct imaging, just by taking a picture of it. This is a difficult observation. What kind of planets would be easiest to find with this method? Like huge, massive, bright planets, right? So whether they're big, whether they're maybe the planet is hot, so it's putting out more light, but usually you're getting the light reflected from the star, so mostly just a big planet is easy to find with this method. Close to us. So the further away the star is, the smaller the whole system looks to us. So if we want to be able to make out a planet next to us, it's easier to see when it's closer. Really great point. Whereas something like the radial velocity method, it really doesn't matter how far away it is, as long as you can get a good spectrum of the star.
Far from the star itself, so that you can block the light better.
Great point. So that if the planet is close to the star, it's going to be pretty hard to find this method. So the further out from the star it is, the easier it will be to find. So this is good for finding large planets far from their stars and the whole system being fairly close to us. So it's not very common that planets are found this way, but it's pretty cool to actually get to see direct light from the planet, to get a picture of the planet. So this is a real picture, unlike most of the other pictures in this talk. Now there's an interesting category of planets that started to emerge around this time, super Earths. So in our solar system, we have terrestrial class planets. The inner planets are all like terrestrial, like Earth-ish size, rocky planets. Then we have the Neptune and Uranus sized planets, and then the Saturn and Jupiter sized planets. And we don't have anything in between Earth and Neptune. We didn't know that planets like that could exist. In fact, I think a lot of astronomers at the time would have said, there's all these reasons why you wouldn't get a planet that size. So then we started finding them around other stars. So the first one found was in 2009, and it was called GJ 1214b. And it is a water world, which is another interesting characteristic of it. So not all super Earths, ones that are a few times Earth size and about maybe 5 to 10 times its mass. Those ones are not all going to be water worlds, but this one is. And the reason that they, I believe that they got an atmosphere on this one because it's fairly close to the star, but I'm forgetting the details on this one. So this one would be made, in fact, mostly of water. They confirmed by looking at its atmosphere that its atmosphere is made mostly of water, but then they also found that the mass and the size of the planet mean that it has a very low density, and its density is a lot less than rock. And actually, its density suggests that the planet is made mostly of water. Now, you might say, well, Earth is mostly water. Like, look at it. It's covered in water. But that's on the outside. So if you look at all of Earth's mass, you got a lot of iron in the middle, a lot of liquid rock and solid rock. There's not very much water. I'm not sure of the exact estimate, but probably less than a percentage, less than 1% of Earth's mass is water. This planet is mostly water. So, and it's also a warm planet. It's close to its star. So it almost certainly doesn't have liquid habitable water, but it would have some really interesting things going on there. It would have a thick, steamy atmosphere made mostly of water vapor. And then at some point, the pressure would get high enough that you would start to get these exotic states of matter, like hot ice, like solid water or ice, but that forms under high pressure, and it's hot. And that is possible, but it's not something you normally see on Earth because we don't have those conditions. But they think that that's probably what's inside this planet is hot ice. Yes?
Can we produce those conditions on Earth?
Yes, we can produce them in the lab. I'm not sure how much of it has been made, but I think that you can make it in a lab. So if you plot for water, you can do temperature and pressure, and so you make a plot of that, and some of the states are familiar to us, steam and liquid water and ice, like the regular ice that we're used to. So those occupy some regions of that graph, but then there are other regions of the graph where physicists do expect exotic states of matter like hot ice.
How hot?
I am not sure in this case. I am thinking...
Not for your coffee.
What was that?
Not for your coffee.
Right? So it would be interesting to put... that would form an interesting kind of iced coffee. Does anyone know how hot this planet is? So I'm guessing it's in the thousands of degrees, but that is a bit of a guess because I'm not sure of the numbers. Yes.
Close to its star?
Yes, it is close to its star. So that's why it's so warm. So we know this isn't habitable, but it's an interesting world, right? And
but then again, you have the problem that at the surface it would be evaporating, no matter what the state was in the middle.
You mean at the surface of the atmosphere, like
at the surface of the planet at 1,000 degrees, the pressure is zero. It's going to boil.
Do you mean at the top of the planet's atmosphere?
Well, if it's mostly water. The surface of the planet.
Right, but then it has a thick atmosphere on top, probably a steam atmosphere, which would be...
Which would evaporate.
Until it reached equilibrium.
There is no equilibrium, because it's always the top. It has kinetic energy and will escape.
Only if it reaches escape velocity, if it's got a, if it's a large mass.
But this, it's only Earth mass.
Well, it's
7 times Earth mass.
Right.
But it is possibly a mechanism for circularization if it comes in, because the evaporating gas can give it the thrust to circularize. It will spiral again.
You're saying it's a way for it to change its orbital dynamics?
If the rotation is right,
right,
it can give a continuous kick.
Sort of a
right.
Planet.
Right. So my understanding is that it is, and if this is an artist's conception. We don't really know. All we know is that it does. Its atmosphere is mostly water vapor, and then its density is low, suggesting that the whole thing is probably mostly water. So the rest is just conjecture. But I'm thinking that it must be under a state of equilibrium like that, where you'd have a thick, steamy atmosphere which supplies the weight to cause a high pressure and something like hot ice down inside. Yes.
Is that where they film the movie?
It would have been a little shorter and maybe less painful. Sorry. So this is not the only super Earth-sized planet that was discovered. Actually, quite a few of them have been found. So this is a common category of planet. Why don't we have one? I mean, it would be kind of cool if we had one in our set, right? But so this kind of planet, for whatever reason, is not represented in our solar system, but does seem to be common out in the universe, although they are not all of this unusual water, hot water world status. Yes? Well, it might have a rocky core. So this one is mostly water, but the rest is probably rock and iron. And so that would probably sink to the center and make some kind of metal and rocky core. However, the question for a lot of these super Earths is, what would they be like? Because Neptune is a gas giant or ice giant kind of planet, and Earth is a rocky planet with a thin atmosphere. So these super Earths, each of them might be different, of course, but would they be like huge rocky worlds or water worlds? Would they be sort of mini Neptunes where they are mostly atmosphere? It's not really clear what they would really look like, and it might depend on the conditions of their formation and like how hot they are, things like that. So you'll see a few others here, a few other examples of guesses for what these super Earths might look like, but that's a big mystery still. Then along came Kepler. So the Kepler spacecraft was launched in 2009, and it was specializing in using the transit method to detect planets. So if you see up here, it's looking at the star, and these planets are passing between the star and the spacecraft. So then they look dark against the star. So that's the method that we're going to use this to explore. And Kepler's mission is to find another Earth. And it was launched in 2009, and it stared at the same patch of sky for about 3 years, which is how long it was intended to look. And so it has a very sensitive photometer, which is what this is. So a photometer collects light. It is not analyzing the spectrum of these objects. It's just collecting the amount of light from these objects. It's just looking at how bright the stars are over time. So it looked at one area of the sky in the constellation Cygnus, uninterrupted for all this time, except for a couple glitches now and then. And so you could look at a star over time and see how its brightness changed. And let me tell you, this is a lot more important than just planets. Having this kind of sensitive data on the brightness of stars has also revolutionized other fields of astronomy, like figuring out how stars work. So Kepler has been a really important mission, not just for planets, but for other fields of astronomy too. Now, in, I think it was 2012, one of the two of the gyroscopes failed, and it has four to keep it in pointing in an accurate position, and it needs three of them in order to keep pointing accurately. So with only two still working, it could not keep pointing at the same place in the sky anymore. So its primary mission was over. It can't stare at that same place anymore. However, it took a lot of data during that time, and astronomers and citizen scientists are continuing to analyze that data for all sorts of discoveries. So you'll still hear about discoveries of things like planets from that phase of Kepler's mission for a long time, while people continue to work on it. Yes?
Didn't it also run out of coolant for its one main instrument?
So you're saying it ran out of coolant for its main instrument? That sounds right. I didn't catch the details on that. Right. So it is still its photometer is still working. It is still able to take its kind of measurements, but it may be affected by that. That's right. So they actually figured out a pretty ingenious solution for how to keep Kepler running. And I'm going to leave that for a discussion at the end if we have time. Okay, so next I'm going to talk about how we find planets using the transit method. And that's what we have our model here for. Here you see one of our volunteers at the Air and Space Museum operating it for the visitors. So what does this look like here? What do we have? So we have some Legos and a light bulb. So what does the light bulb represent? So it's a sun or star, and as you pointed out, super giant, right, compared to the planets.
Or at least, no, I guess not close.
Right.
It's not giant compared to those planets, I guess. It's very close to them.
It's
right.
Legos,
mm-hmm.
Not too scary.
Right. Right. So the proportions of the star and the planet and the distances are a little bit funny compared to what they would be in a real solar system. Real solar systems are made of a lot of empty space. So you'd have to put these out at the bathrooms, at the bathhouse or something like that, that sort of thing. So this is our model of a solar system. And see if one of the gears is a little bit shaky, but let's see if we can keep it working for this demo here. So this represents Kepler. This is a very cheap version of Kepler, a photometer. You see these a lot in physics classrooms in high school. That they work great. We can use a software called Logger Light to interface with it. You can do all sorts of experiments with something like this. So this is looking at the star. And what is happening as the planets go around? So the planets are sometimes blocking the light, right? We're going to do a little experiment here. By the way, if you're interested in this and you'd like to build your own, here are our instructions on the Kepler website about how to do it. Not all of the parts are still for sale, so you may have to scrounge a bit or come up with different alternatives for that. Also, help yourself to the bookmarks. This is the Kepler website. This is the observatory where I work at the Air and Space Museum. And this is my contact information if you want to get in touch with me. Okay, so here we have a graph that we're going to use here. This is time. We can go up to 40 seconds. And this is the amount of light that the planet is, that this is seeing from the star over time. So do you want to help us out by tapping that button? And let's see. Sorry, just a moment. It's doing something funny. I need a moment. Thank you. I think in the long time it's been sitting here, it forgot about the sensor. So I'll need just a minute to get that working again. Apologies for that. That's right, and it's having a bit of a safe mode issue right now. Right. Yes, absolutely. All right, we'll be ready in just a minute.
So Kepler still has a mission.
What was that?
Kepler still has a mission.
Kepler is still operating. That's right. All right, will you help us out again? Okay, so now we've got, as time goes on, so you're seeing the amount of light from the star over time. So tell me when we're going to see another big dip.
Small one, medium one,
right above.
Small one,
no.
Big one.
Work.
Right. Yeah, you are good. Yeah.
Medium one, small one.
Right. So you're seeing dips for each of the kinds of planets, right? So you have an advantage here. The motor's choking a bit. That's why it's it hesitated there. Okay, I'm going to give it a break now. Okay, so thank you. Yeah, it's pretty cool, right? This was made by staff and volunteers and friends of the museum. And it's been really fun to work with. So you have an advantage. You got to watch it happen. Now tell me, if you could only see this, if you can't see this, what can you tell me about the solar system we're looking at? Because in real life, we can't see most other solar systems in this kind of detail. We can only see this, the amount of light from the star over time. Or we can use other methods, like the radial method. So what can we tell, just based on this, about that star system? Yes?
One big object blocked the light.
One big object blocked the light? That's right. Yes?
There's three different sizes of objects in the system.
Okay, three different sizes. Here's one, another, and another. That's great. Anything else we can find out? Yes? Okay, great. That's a big topic there. That's a good one to bring up. So, you can how many times does a big one transit, meaning pass between the star and the telescope? Three times, right? Three is good. One time it could be anything. It could be a random planet passing through space between you and the star. It could be the star varying. It could be any kind of blip in the noise. Two times, okay, well, huh, that's interesting. But then that lets you predict the third time. And then if you're right, like you all did, in fact, you did it on the second time because you could see it. But if you can predict on its third pass, then you know you've got a planet. Now, extra passes only give you more confirmation of its orbital parameters. So three passes for the big one, not very often, right? And which one is passing the most often? The little one, right? Why? Yes? It's closest to the sun. It's not because it's the smallest one. It's because it's the closest that's passing most often. Yes?
Is that always true? It's the fastest, but is it always the closest?
Great point. We can tell from this that the small planet is the fastest. Does that mean that it is the closest? Yes. We have Johannes Kepler to thank for that. The objects that are closest to the star will orbit the fastest. So it's not Mercury is named after the god of speed. Of the messenger god, not because it is the smallest planet, but because it is close to the sun. Yes?
Can you, with that reading, can you tell how the orbit is shaped?
Good question. Can you tell how the orbit is shaped from this? I am not sure, because even if it has an elliptical orbit, it will still pass between the telescope and the star at the same time in each orbit. If you have a good light curve and you can analyze the shape of the wings of it, that might tell you a little bit about its orbital parameters. Also, the planets are interacting with each other gravitationally. In fact, you can even find planets you can't see with this method that are not transiting because of their disturbance on the other planets, which is how Neptune was found. So that might help you find it. I'm not sure. Most planets are pretty circular in orbit, so I have not heard whether that makes much difference. So,
the shape of those things you tell, because one shape will be wider when it's
depending on the major axis of
it. It's a perihelion, it'll move faster across, and the dimming will go up and down real quickly. But if it's moving across
right.
The star from very far away.
So, you're saying that when it's moving across from very far away, it's on a slower part of its orbit, so it'll move slower across, have a wider transit, versus when it's at its closest point, when it will move fast across. However, we only see it transit at one point in its orbit. We can't go to a different angle and compare.
Right.
So, it might tell us, the width of it might tell us a little bit about that. But really, as you were pointing out, the time between these is telling us how long it takes the planet to go around the star. This tells you the year for the big planet is that long. Like that's what a year is on that planet. And the year for the little planet is a lot shorter, which tells us the little planet is closer. In fact, you can figure out exactly how close if you can figure out how massive the star is, which you figure out by based on how bright it is and figuring out how far away it is, which is another difficult situation. Yes? It's a really good point. So what could Kepler find? Right, so there's a reason why the primary mission for Kepler was 3 years. They wanted to find another Earth. And how long do you have to look at our solar system to see Earth? Well, if you get really lucky, 2 years in one day, right? Because if it happens on the first day, and then halfway through, and then the last day. However, to be sure, you really want to look for 3 years. because you can't count on getting that lucky about the timing.
Have they been using the data to look at the wobble in the star as well and integrate it with this data?
Yes. So you remember I talked about the water world, GJ1214b. So for that one, we know the size of the planet using this, transits. And we know the mass of the planet using its how much it makes the star wobble. Combining those, you get the density of the planet, which tells you its density must be pretty low. So these two methods go together very well. You get a lot of information when it transits, and you get the radial velocity method. You can tell a lot about the planet. So you did a great job with this. You figured out how many planets are in this solar system, how big they are, relatively speaking, and how close they are to the stars. Yes? Okay, right. So if they were the same size, but at different orbits, right? Right. So if you had one that was maybe twice as far out as the other, but they were the same size, it would be a lot more confusing than this because you'd see what looked like irregular dips. However, you could piece that out and say, well, it doesn't make sense as one because they would not be regular distances apart. Could it be two? And then you would either examine it visually or probably run a computer model on it to figure out. Yes, it could be two, and they have those different orbits. Yes?
And then you could potentially combine it with other methods of detection to see what, in fact, each scenario would have.
Yes, that's right. So you could, using the different methods tells you a lot about the planets. That's right.
But if there were planets further out that took much longer, you wouldn't know they're there.
Right, so Kepler can't find something that's far enough out. Maybe he got lucky and saw one transit of a very distant planet, but it did not get the second and third confirming transits.
And that would be a wobble
too, wouldn't it? So you would still be able to see the wobble, however, maybe if you weren't looking for long enough. So Kepler wasn't examining the spectra. You'd have to do different observations to get the spectra. So even with a short observation, you can get a little bit of the wobble, but the longer you look, the more sure you can be. Yes. So something like a Jupiter or Saturn in this system would cause the star to wobble far more than just the planets. So if you're seeing something Earth-sized transiting, but you're seeing a lot of wobble in the star, that can probably tell you there's something else there, but it might make it hard to figure out the parameters of this planet. Yes?
I'm curious, approximately how many stars were in Kepler's field of
view? How many stars were in Kepler's field of view? It is in the hundreds of thousands. That's a good question. Why did they decide to look at that one region in Cygnus with Kepler? I'm not sure. All the stars are pretty far away, some in the hundreds or thousands of light years away. So it's not good for finding stars particularly close to us. I believe that there are a lot of stars there. I mean, Cygnus is in the Milky Way. So you see a lot of stars in that field of view. So you might as well look in an area where there are many, so you have better chances of seeing them. So people have closely examined Alpha Centauri and Proxima Centauri for signs of planets. And I believe they found planets around, I hope I'm remembering this right. I thought they found planets around Proxima Centauri, but they cannot be habitable. Is that,
I think it was Proxima, not Alpha.
Right. But they are definitely not habitable planets. And they are pretty sure that there are no habitable planets. They have ruled that out for the closest star system. Kepler did not do that. Other observations before Kepler did. All right, so now that I've warmed you up, now I'm going to test you. So I need your cooperation on this. I need you to all close your eyes for a few minutes, and I'm going to rearrange the planets and then hide it from your view, and all you'll get to see is that, and you'll have to tell me what the star system looks like. So help me out here by closing your eyes. I'll also block it from the camera's point of view for now. Everyone ready? Okay, let's see if I can do this without abusing the model here. Okay, can everyone see the screen? I will ask, would you like to help us out this time? Okay, and I will watch the model carefully to make sure I'm not hitting it with a box. And you can go ahead and start collecting data. Oh, I have to turn on. That would help.
Hit it again?
Or? Hit it firmly once, see if that works. There you go. I'm just going to watch this closely.
No, you're blocking the
foot. Oh, sorry. Would you restart the experiment for us?
Okay.
And one more time. Almost there. All right, thank you very much. Yes, okay, I'm gonna leave that there for now. While you could, thank you. And try not to cause a fire. Okay, so what solar system do we have here? Yes.
The closer one.
Why do you say the big one's the closer one?
Because
it's more frequent?
Frequently across the planet.
Right, so we see more transits from what seems to be the biggest dip, and so that's the biggest planet. So we have a hot Jupiter, something, a big planet close to the star, that's right. How many planets do we have here? Can anyone tell?
Three.
Sounds like everyone's agreeing it's three? Okay, great.
The smallest planet seems to be the furthest out slash slowest of these planets.
Okay, so you're saying the smallest one and this one here? So we only see one, two, and three transits for that one. Great. And then
medium planet is also the medium.
Right. So we have a medium number of transits for the middle one. I didn't move that one. I swapped the other two. Great job. Okay, so this time we have a reversal. We have a hot Jupiter. Let me show it to you now. Well done, well done. So you also know, you said that they're different sizes than the previous ones. That actually, they're the same size. However, our system is a little funny because our telescope is so close to the star that how close it is to the planets, you're not going to get the same effects as you move the planet the same size further out. From our vantage point so far away from these stars, Kepler will see the same effect. It doesn't really matter how far away from the star the planet is. But in this model, it does matter how far you put out the planet. So the bigger planet makes a smaller dip here than it did when it was close to the star and blocked more of the field of view of the star. So great job on that. So you are ready to analyze Kepler data. Okay, so I'll give that a break and close this. Okay. Of course.
Thank you.
And my laptop here is generating quite a lot of heat. Apologies about that. So I'm going to cover some of the presentation mode, some of the interesting discoveries from Kepler. So this will be sort of like a tour of Kepler discoveries here. So some interesting results include this one, Kepler 11 from 2011, which was discovered in 2011. This one has six detected planets so far, which are all very close to the star. Five of them are closer than Mercury.
Oh.
And the other one is roughly Earth's orbit. Yes?
Do you have radial velocities from any of these?
I'm not sure if these have been detected, if these have been observed spectroscopically. Probably. I think it's an interesting system. I'd be surprised if someone didn't also do that. Right, although you can get a lot in the orbit just from the photometry, from the amount of light over time. That tells you a lot about the orbital parameters, but not so much about the actual mass of the planets, only their size. So if you want to get their density, you also need the radial velocity method. So astronomers didn't think this could happen. This is a recurring thing. They didn't think you could cram this many planets into such a small dynamical space, having so many planets in a closer to their star than Mercury. They're orbiting stably. They're not going in anywhere. This one caused a lot of waves. Kepler 16b has been nicknamed Tatooine. Why? Because of Star Wars. Because it is like the planet Tatooine in Star Wars. It is a planet with two suns. Now, it is not exactly like Tatooine. It is not a desert world. It is not habitable, but it does have two suns. This is the first time that a planet was found orbiting a pair of suns. Now, astronomers knew this was generally possible, but they didn't think this was possible. They didn't think it was possible for the planet to be this close to its pair of stars without being disrupted by the gravity of those stars as they move around each other. So again, this is a place where astronomers had ruled out this exact kind of system and then were surprised again that it was possible for the planet to orbit so close to its pair of stars. So if you were standing on the star, you'd have two suns in your sky. Yes. So could it do sort of like a figure eight between the stars? So one of the things I did in my physics courses was rule that out. So I don't think so. However, what's the theme of this? Right. So I really don't think so. But I'm not going to bet any money on that right now.
Well, so is it orbiting around the common center of gravity or around close to one of them?
It is orbiting the common center of gravity of the system, which is dominated by the two stars. So the common center of gravity of these two stars is probably in between them, although I'm not sure for these exact stars. Maybe one is much more massive than the other. So it is going around, you have two stars in a tight orbit and a planet a little further out, like this.
Probably not a real circular orbit. But
you're saying you don't think it's a really circular orbit?
Because
why?
It's going close to each of those stars.
Which is why astronomers thought this was impossible. But it does seem to have a circular orbit, a stable orbit here. Not that a non-circular orbit is unstable. So this is the first time that this has been discovered, and since then, many others have been discovered. So most stars in the sky have companions. The sun is a little bit unusual, being on its own. Astronomers have been wondering, is it possible for all those stars in the sky that have companions to also have planets? Yes, it is possible. And maybe some planets are going around one star while another star is further out, or maybe some planets are going around both stars. And there's even another interesting possibility. This planet was found not by professional astronomers, but by citizen scientists. Citizen science is when people just getting involved in advancing the frontiers of science without having a professional degree in that field and a professional job in that field. Anyone can do citizen science. I really recommend doing it. I was talking to you just today about some citizen science in bird watching. And one way you can do it is to go to this website, planethunters.org, and analyze Kepler data. So computers are combing Kepler data, looking for these planets, looking for the dips like you did. However, the human eye is sometimes better than the computer at doing it. So they've asked people to help, just to go look at light curves, just like you did with this model a few minutes ago. Many people have done that. They have found some planets, and this is a planet that was found. It's shown here. It is in a four-star system. So not only was this a first for the Citizen Science Project, they also found a kind of planet that had never been found before. This is a planet orbiting two stars, so it is a circumbinary planet, a planet that goes around a pair of stars, and these pair of stars are also orbiting another pair of stars further out. So you have two pairs orbiting each other, and there's a planet around one of them. So that's pretty cool. And it was not professionals who found this. Yes. Really? Okay. When I checked, when I made my talk, I visited the site and they said we're out of K2 data.
But K1 was still there. K1 a couple hours ago. It looks like it got emptied out.
Okay. So thanks for the update on that. So maybe you can't do this right now. So
you go through the demo,
right.
But you wind up with no data sets available.
So there are
other Boink projects too.
What was that?
There are other Boink projects too.
The universe is full of others.
So there are a constellation of citizen science projects out there, including many interesting astronomy citizen science projects. And what the people running those projects have discovered is that people like to do this, and they are hungry for more data. So people are actually processing the data for some of these projects faster than the project scientists can give it to them. So currently, it sounds like they have that the project scientists have determined that there's nothing more to be gained from citizen scientists analyzing the main mission of Kepler. However, Kepler is still collecting data in its K2 mission. Right now, they don't have any data to hand off to the citizen science project, but they will at some point. And in the meantime, as you pointed out, there are many other awesome projects to get involved with. So that's pretty exciting that that people went accomplished that, going through all that data. So the double-double is an example of a system like this, but we don't know whether it has planets. At least I don't know whether it has planets. So this is I don't know where the star is located in the sky. It is not a Kepler planet. Sorry, it is a Kepler planet. It's found by citizen scientists. So it's in the constellation Cygnus then. So Kepler has found quite a few super-Earths. This is one example of an artist concept of one solar system that Kepler has been analyzing. So they're really interesting, this class of super-Earths. And so 62E and 62F were, at the time, the planets most similar to Earth that had been found. And they are larger than Earth. They're super-Earths, so we're not really sure what they'd be like. Whether they be rocky, whether they be covered with oceans, whether they would have a thick atmosphere. But this is a guess for what they might look like. And they are in the habitable zone of their star. So this is when Kepler started finding planets that might be rocky, might be watery, we're not really sure, but that are the correct distance from their star, they're getting the right amount of light that they could have liquid water on the surface. Now this is a faint red star compared to our sun. So the habitable zone is closer to the star than it is for our sun. So you're not getting as much light from the star, so you have to be closer in order to get enough heat to keep water liquid. It also has a number of other interesting planets in the same system. So Kepler has been finding a whole range of interesting super-Earths as well. And this is pretty fun. So we've been looking at planets around regular stars now for 20 years. And this is the number of planets discovered each year. And I believe the red is by Kepler. Yes, the red is by Kepler. The blue is other methods. And in 2014, something interesting happened. The Kepler scientists found a new way of processing the data from Kepler. They found a way of confirming what planets in multiple planet systems. And so in one data release, so in the July of that year, they announced all these new planets. Wow. They had to change the axes on the graph in order to fit them all in. So they in that one, I'm not sure why it went away, I'll play it again. In that one time, they announced about 700 new planets, and these aren't just, I think it's a planet, these are, I know it's a planet, confirmed planets. And at that point, Kepler really started to take off in terms of the number of planets it had found. Yes?
You said that the blue part of the bar was other methods. Is that include things like the citizen science projects and that sort of thing?
So the citizen science project that we mentioned analyzes Kepler data, so that is part of this, of that. There are planets being found by the transit method, but not by Kepler. And there are also planets being found by other methods.
So why is there a decline in the blue?
That's a good question. So maybe the low-hanging fruit had been found, and maybe it was just a little harder to find planets with those methods without the right new kinds of instruments. Yes?
Just a quick question about that. Does the lettering system refer to the order the planets were discovered, not necessarily their orbit, or is it their position in
next? Oh, you're wondering about the one back here with the...
That one seems to line up, but I think I've seen other ones where their letter doesn't correspond to their order in orbit necessarily.
Right. I was just reading an article about this one earlier today, trying to find out what's going on with this one, and it was called 62C in that early article. I think before they had found the earlier one. So I think they might renumber them based on the orbit.
Because
Because that makes more sense.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's hard either way, right? Yeah. Yes.
I noticed that the planet names always are start with B and there's never an A.
So the star is A. Although that gets confusing when you have a binary star, because you have the star A, the star B, and then the planet B. So it's, for the star, they usually use a capital letter, I believe, or okay. they don't put a letter at all often. Okay. And then for the planet, it's a lowercase letter. Right. How are we doing for time? Okay. So there are many awesome ways of finding planets, but Kepler has been producing some really exciting results. And here is a survey of what Kepler has been doing to find habitable worlds. For reference, we have Earth and the Sun. And in 2011, in December of 2011, the discovery of Kepler 20e was announced. And this was the first planet that was ever discovered that was smaller than the Earth. So we now know about planets around other stars that are smaller than our Earth. And since then, they found even smaller ones than that. They have not yet found an exo-moon, a moon around a planet around another star. They're working on it. I'm really excited for that. So that was around a star a little bit cooler, a little bit smaller and cooler and redder than our sun. In the same month, they announced the discovery of Kepler 22b, a super-Earth, actually quite a large super-Earth. And this one is around a similar star as Kepler 20e, and it is in the habitable zone. So this was the first time that they were, let's see, what was the significance of that one? Just a moment. So it was an exciting planet because they believed that it could be habitable, and it could easily be covered in a global ocean, but it's unlikely to have a solid surface, because if it is covered in ocean, there's unlikely to be any land that goes above the surface. So it's interesting to think what that planet might be like. Kepler 186f, discovered in April of 2014, is the first time that an Earth-sized planet, pretty close to the size of Earth, was discovered in the habitable zone of a star. So that's really exciting. This could be like another Earth, except its star is a cool red dwarf, very different than our sun. So it's entirely possible that Kepler 186f is a very nice place to live. However, we don't really know what it would be like around a red dwarf. There would probably be more solar flares. Would the extra ultraviolet light from that have cooked life on that planet and made it hard and broken up DNA or similar molecules for life on that planet? So we don't know. So they still wanted to find something that was around a sun-like star. Yes?
When you say the habitable zone, is that adjusted by things like radiation pressures and temperature because of the radiation, the infrared radiation from the star?
Right, so you're saying it's a habitable zone affected by things like radiation pressure from the star and other factors like that? That's a really good question. The habitable zone is a murky factor, what it means, right? Because the atmosphere of the planet can strongly affect whether it's in the habitable zone. Mars is in the habitable zone, but it's not very habitable right now because it doesn't have enough atmosphere. But it might have been, early in its history. Whereas Earth would be actually quite cool without the greenhouse effect that we have from its gases. So they are mostly taken into account just the light from the star and not other factors like solar flares or the atmospheres of the planets. But those things would probably affect whether it would be habitable. So we have some more to learn on how to refine the habitable zone for different kinds of stars. So a white dwarf is the leftover cinder of a sun-like star after it dies.
But it's still putting out some energy.
Right, that's actually quite a lot, so it can be quite bright. It's like basically the leftover core of a sun-like star after the outer layers are stripped away in a planetary nebula. And it's very small, so you'd have to be close. But it's also very hot. So it does put out a fair bit of light, but this would be mostly hard light, like blue and maybe ultraviolet light, and then over time it would gradually cool down. So you could have a close-in planet that would possibly be habitable, but again, is it really a friendly place for life?
The fanciful idea I have is like, you know, if in the future true. We had the technology to move Earth. We could move it out when the sun went red giant and then move it back in when it went white.
Right. So the idea that maybe we could move our own Earth as our sun changes its habitable zone drastically. It's going to change it pretty fast.
Yeah.
So that's a really interesting question.
That would be an important reason to study how planets move in and out in their own natural environments, so we might be able to stimulate that kind of phenomenon.
Right. If we can understand why planets are migrating this way, we could maybe stimulate it ourselves in some futuristic environment. Now, the average lifespan of a species is 1 million years, and we're talking about events 5 billion years from now. So let's see if we can get through our average lifespan of our species first before we tackle those.
Well, we may exceed our natural individual lifespan of 100 years or so in the next few years or decades.
Right. There are a lot of questions about whether intelligence is, what it will do for the lifespan of a species, positive or negative, to be determined. So the crowning achievement that I mentioned earlier happened last month. That was when an Earth-sized planet was found in the habitable zone of a sun-like star. So that's Kepler 452b. As far as we know, it's another Earth. We don't really know whether it has liquid water or whether life could form anywhere other than Earth. But we found it.
Was it 2 times the mass of Earth?
So right, it is a fair bit bigger than Earth. It's not in the super Earth class. It's in the Earth class, but it's certainly considerably bigger than Earth.
But it would support development of Superman.
Is there speculation that like an astronaut could actually even could you function eventually and adapt to that level of gravity?
Right. So the gravity is not necessarily that much higher on the surface of a larger planet because it also depends on things like the density of the planet. So we don't know what the surface gravity would be like on that planet. We can assume that it would be higher than Earth, probably. So could life at all survive in that environment? Well, it's probably not that much higher, so yes, we could probably imagine life that could survive. Could we humans survive? We'd probably need some genetic adaptation in order to survive in a higher gravity environment. Yes?
Are these also called Goldilocks planets?
So Goldilocks planets refer to planets in the habitable zone. Not too hot, not too cold, just right. Right. So we don't know if it's just right in some senses. We don't know what the star is really like whether it has maybe solar flares that are damaging for the life. We don't know if this planet lost its atmosphere like Mars did, or if it even had an atmosphere at all, or what other factors they may be. But as far as we can tell, it is just right. Yes. And so this is the first, and I'm sure there will be many more. So this is indicating to us that the universe is full of planets. I'm not sure, but most of the stars in the Kepler field are hundreds of light years.
I think they said that one was 1,400.
Okay, yeah. So most of the Kepler planets are in that range. So this is a depiction of Kepler 452b compared to the Earth. It's also what was in the animation in the first slide. So yes, bigger. And this is a guess for what it might look like if it's a rocky world. We don't know. This is entirely a guess, but it's a plausible guess. And here is a depiction of the habitable zones of those of Earth and those last two. So here's the solar system and Earth. Here we have Kepler 452b. Its star is so similar to the sun that its habitable zone is identical to our solar systems. And the orbit of Kepler 452b is so similar to Earth's. I think its year is something like 380 days. So it is right in the same place in its habitable zone as we are. So that's pretty cool. And then Kepler 186, the one around the cool red dwarf, is depicted up here. That's a smaller planet, closer in size to Earth. But it's in its habitable zone, but we don't really know what it would be like around this cool red star. So it's a really exciting era for finding small, rocky, possibly habitable planets. So here's a summary of some of the ones that Kepler has found. Quite a few around red dwarf stars, and around some that are just a little bit cooler and redder than the sun. And then we only know about two planets that are really just like Earth. Earth itself and Kepler 452b. That, as far as we know, is very similar to Earth around a sun-like star. So here come the graphs. Okay, so this is as of 2014 data. On the left, we have a graph showing the planets that have been found excluding Kepler. So here we have the year for the planets in days. So this is 1 day, 10 days, 100 days, 1,000 days, etc. Here we have the mass of the planets in units of mass of Earth. So Earth is here, Neptune's here, etc. So here we have planets found using all sorts of different methods. So blue is a transit method. Pink is the radial velocity method. So what kind of planets is the radial velocity method good at finding? You're saying large Jupiter-sized planets? So that's why the pink is mostly up here. That's right. What else?
Fast, short period planets.
Right. So right. So a lot of them do seem to be pretty far out. It's true, but there are some that are close in as well. The hot Jupiters are here. So most, it seems like these ones are the ones that are easy for the radial velocity method to find, the ones that are close in and large. However, it has mostly found ones out here, so there probably are more planets like that out there.
Well, the radial velocity, does that fit on sort of a line, which is a combination, the best combination of mass and period?
It looks to me like it's more of a region.
Yeah.
Like it's finding all of these. So the radial velocity method is not very good at finding small planets in close and far out orbits. Everything else it seems to be pretty good at finding. What kind of planets are easiest to find with the imaging method?
Close
to us, that's right, which is not shown on this graph. Distance from us is not included. Anything else? So hot planets are easier to see with the imaging method because we might see their own light, especially if we look in infrared light where the contrast between the star and the planet is not as high. Right, that's a really good point.
Big ones,
that's right. So the imaging is shown in dark blue and they're all really big planets and they're all really far out. What kind of method is best to find with the transit? What kind of planet is most easily found with the transit method? Large ones in short periods. So that's why we're seeing the transit method is mostly finding large planets close into the star with short years. That's right. Okay, so this is a summary as of 2014 of everything excluding Kepler. Let's throw in Kepler. So this is the same graph, except they converted the mass of the planet to an estimate of the radius of the planet, just assuming that. So you could put all that data on the same graph, because that's what you know for Kepler. You know the planetary radius, but you don't know its mass. So Kepler has been really productive. And it's also been finding a lot of the more Earth-like planets. What kind of planets can Kepler not find? So the long period ones, right? So it just hasn't been looking long enough. It chops off pretty sharply. You have to get really lucky in order to see the ones that are further out with Kepler. Yes? So how are we going to find planets like Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune with any of these methods? So, because those are far out, and some of them are not that big. So the big far out ones are pretty easy to find using the radial method. Not as easy as the hot Jupiters, but a lot of them have been found. There must be a ton out there, right, if it's easier to find these, but they're seeing more of these. However, the Neptunes, where is it? I'm not sure where Neptune actually goes, but it's got to be in here somewhere. So those are not being found. So none of these methods are very good at finding Neptune. Yeah. Right. So why are there known planets at lower right? It's just the summary of this. Those ones are really hard to see. It's not that we don't think that there are planets out there. It's that the small, far-out planets none of these methods are good at finding. Even the intermediate mass far out planets are really hard to find. So this is what we found so far, and we're finding a lot now, but it's not a survey of all planets out there. Yes?
How high up is Kepler's orbit? Is it like higher than the Hubble telescope, or is it?
I can't remember if Kepler. Right, sharing Earth's orbit around the sun, is that right? I don't. Right, so it's leading or trailing Earth's orbit, we're not sure which.
I just wondered if it was it would probably never be feasible then to fix it, you'd probably just launch another one.
It would probably be much cheaper to launch another one. And there are some interesting missions that are being considered, and I'm not sure what the status of them is, but the TESS is the Transiting Earth Survey something, I think. Other missions like this are designed to find Earth-like planets, and others to analyze the atmospheres.
Is the James Webb telescope going to do anything for finding planets?
So the James Webb will be excellent at analyzing atmospheres of planets. It won't be necessarily so good at finding them because it's so big and time on it will be so highly valued that it can't spend long on any staring at any one patch of space. But if we know there's a planet there and we know it's going to transit at a certain time, that's a great time to point James Webb there and analyze the atmosphere because it has so much sensitivity. The plan is to launch it in 2018, and last I heard it is on schedule. Yes.
So one other place that maybe is a difficulty of all of these methods of detection is, what if you had a planet whose orbital inclination was such that we couldn't see it by transit, and it was small enough that radio velocity measurements wouldn't?
And imaging wouldn't find it either. So how do we find planets that don't transit the star, and and we can't find them the radial method, either because they're too small or because they're tipped up too much to us, like maybe they're face on or something like this. That's hard to find those. So maybe we can't find them. However, we can infer their presence. So Kepler's looking at hundreds of thousands of stars, and we just announced Kepler 452b last month. So it's found planets around roughly 500 stars in the hundreds or 100,000 or so that it's looking at. So it's only finding planets around a tiny fraction, but it only expects to find planets around a tiny fraction because only a tiny fraction would transit. So you can just use the geometry of saying, well, if Kepler's here, the star's here, and only planets in this angle would transit, then all of these angles would not transit, and so we expect there to be X many more planets than we're finding. And using that, they've concluded that there would be billions of planets in our solar system, and that most stars would have planets around them. So we don't know, haven't found all of those, but we can infer their presence based on the sample that we are studying. So planets are common in the galaxy. A big change in 20 years, right? Yeah. So this is just a summary of planets that have been found as of August, and I know it's hard to see here, but so this is planets found using the transiting method with Kepler. These are 10% of the planets found were with other transiting detections, not Kepler. This is the radial velocity method, about 31%, and then just a few percent for other methods, imaging, microlensing, or a variety of other possible ways to find planets. So it has been a very productive way to find planets. So as of now, there are almost 2,000 confirmed planets in existence. However, Kepler finds quite a few planets that it's not quite sure of. Those are called planet candidates. And then you have to do follow-up observations, either with Kepler or often with other telescopes, to confirm that, yes, it really is transiting regularly. Like, I'm expecting to see a transit then, and I do. So Kepler has many more candidate planets than confirmed detections. So of these confirmed ones, just over 1,000, so more than half, were found by Kepler. And those are the confirmed, we know it's a planet ones. However, if you also include the planet candidates, the ones where it's not confirmed yet, but statistically about 90% of those do check out as planets. So we can say that most of those are going to be confirmed planets. So the current total number of known planets is about 5,000 or more than 5,000, although not all of those will check out. Most of them will check out. So it's a pretty exciting time. So that's what we've done in 20 years of progress between 51 Pegasi being in 1995 and Kepler 452b last month. We've gone from finding the first hot Jupiter and not really knowing how many stars would have planets, what those planets would look like, where they would be, if it's possible for there to be another Earth out there, to finding something that looks like another Earth, and also having a pretty good census of what kind of planets are out there. Not a complete census, we can't find the Neptunes, but a pretty good census that there are a lot of planets out there of all different shapes and sizes. Of course, I have to also mention what Sabrina mentioned in her talk yesterday, this very exciting result from ALMA, which is a radio or submillimeter array in a desert in Chile. And as it's ramping up its science operations, it's already returning the most marvelous views of the universe. This is a picture. It is not an artist's concept. This is a picture taken by ALMA. This is the highest resolution picture ALMA has ever taken. And it is of a newborn star and a disk around that star. And you can see gaps in the disk, which are almost certainly shepherded by newborn planets that are orbiting around the star. In fact, some of these clumps might even be the planets themselves. And so those newborn planets are gathering gas and shepherding gaps in the rings, and they're so young. The system is younger than the astronomers thought that planets could form. Again, the recurring theme. They didn't think this could happen, but it is happening, and now we have a picture of it. So there, Sabrina showed a beautiful artist concept yesterday of what astronomers thought this would look like, although they didn't realize it would be in a system this young. And this is a real image, and we know it is happening this way. So it's not just Kepler. There are a lot of exciting projects out here for finding all sorts of interesting things about how planets form, why they're migrating the way they do, how many form, what sizes they are, and hopefully one day if there might be life. You might be interested in checking out some of JPL's resources. How many of you have seen these posters? Okay. So JPL has started the Exoplanet Travel Bureau. JPL is an arm of NASA. So they're featuring some of the planets that NASA has been finding. You'll recognize Kepler 16b, where your shadow always has company, is the tagline for that. So these kind of retro vintage travel poster style posters are really fun for popularizing what's going on with exoplanet science right now. These are available for full resolution download on the JPL website, if you'd like to check it out for yourself. So this planet would be very hot. We're not sure if you could actually stand on the surface. So this is a bit of a stretch, but it really does have two suns like that. This is another fun one. Visit the planet with no star, PSO J318.522, where the nightlife never ends. This is a rogue planet, a planet with no star, a planet floating between the stars. Maybe we had a planet like that got ejected from our solar system early on. And they have been found out there. One way to find these is with microlensing, which I'm not going to get into here. It's another whole big topic. But you can find planets just floating out there between the stars all by themselves. How do they get there? How many are out there? And what are they like? These are open questions. So these posters are kind of fun if you want to check them out on the website. Yes?
Just related to the idea of rogue planets, do they think that the hot Jupiters are more likely planets that formed in that solar system and then moved in, or that they're captured, or do they not know which is more likely?
So it's probably much more likely that the hot Jupiters formed in that system and migrated inward, because it's really hard to capture something and have it end up in a stable orbit that close in. It's hard capturing something, and often you end up with backwards orbits, elliptical orbits, right. So some of our moons in our solar system that have the weirdest orbits are the captured ones. So it having a normal, although very tight orbit, suggests it probably did form there. You might also be interested in checking out JPL's Eyes on Exoplanet software package. It's a great way to explore the recent science of exoplanets, a very powerful package, one of several that they're working on. So it's a software package that you can download to explore more about planets. And I put up a picture here about the K2 mission, because I'm guessing that was one thing that you might be curious about. But so just as a summary of who I am, I'm at the National Air and Space Museum. I'm an astronomy educator there. I hope you will all visit me there. Get in touch with me if you'd like to, if you'd like me to show you around, or you can just email us at the observatory too. Please visit us if you want to volunteer with us. We're always looking for more volunteers. And thank you so much for making me my experience at the Star Party so rewarding and useful and really awe-inspiring. So thanks. Yes? Right, so could an odd orbit turn into a normal orbit, like if it's captured and then eventually transitions into a normal orbit? Yes, that can happen. So, for example, the moon is tidally locked to the Earth, as are most moons in the solar system, and eventually the Earth will also be tidally locked to the moon. If the moon's in your sky, it'll always be in your sky. So orbits do change over time, and things sort of settle down into what is normal, like what's tidal locking is sort of a long-term thing that happens to many objects. However, I'm not sure if it could happen to that degree of bringing a massive object, capturing it, and bringing it that close to the star. But we really don't know how they got there. They have run some computer models simulating planet migration, and it's starting to make sense. No one guessed it, I don't think, before, not that I heard of, before we found hot Jupiters. But now that we know about them, it's starting to make sense with computer models that they would migrate inward. Yes?
Could you explain a little bit about how the solar wind maintains Kepler in the K2 mission?
Right, so I thought you might be curious about this. So Kepler only has two working gyroscopes, so it can't point anywhere at once in the sky. However, there's something pretty cool that they figured out to keep Kepler working, because it's a perfectly good telescope. It just can't point very accurately. So what they discovered is that the solar wind can act to help Kepler pointing in a certain direction. The solar wind are particles streaming away from the sun. So these are particles of usually hydrogen moving away from the sun in all directions, sort of blowing a bubble out into the solar system. And as they stream past Kepler, it's sort of like water, or like if you're a sailboat, how you might interact with the wind or with the water, like how a kayak tends to line itself up downstream. So if you point Kepler just right, then the solar wind streams over its solar panel symmetrically and keeps it stable, sort of. And then you can use the other two gyroscopes to make slight adjustments as needed. So if it goes a little bit off, then then you have asymmetric flow and it doesn't help. So you have to keep it pointed in pretty much the right direction, and then the solar wind will help. It'll act as the third gyroscope. It is not pointing it directly away from the sun, but sort of at an angle, sort of like it's sailing on the solar wind. So what they did is they figured out that they could do this, and the Kepler scientists wrote a proposal to keep Kepler going and keep using its data, and they identified 12 patches around, is it 12? Maybe it was 10, but I thought it was 12, patches around the solar system where it could point over the course of the year. And I think it points to one for about 3 months and then moves to another, so it doesn't get to all of them in the course of a year. And so it uses the solar wind to help keep pointing in that direction, and then its other two gyroscopes to keep pointing at those patches for a time. So now it can look in totally different areas of the sky than it did before, including some areas with stars that are much, much closer than it's been looking for its primary mission. And it has started finding planets in its K2 mission. It's found, I think, about 22 planets in the K2 mission so far, and it's really just gotten started. And these will be all sorts of different planets, some much closer to us, but since it can't point at the same zone for such a long time, there'll be bigger holes in the data. So it'll be harder to work with in some ways. So Kepler's still flying. Does that make sense? They're making do, I would say. I mean, it was certainly more flexible when they could point it anywhere they wanted, but they're...
But they constrained themselves.
Right, because it was really...
They wanted to look over a long period of time, and now they kind of can't.
Right. It was so scientifically valuable to stare at the same patch of sky for a long time. And again, not just for planets. Looking at how single stars change brightness over the period of years, no one had done that before with such sensitivity for so many stars for such a long time. And it is a wealth of data, and it's really transforming our understanding of stars themselves. So it was, it's really a shame that it couldn't keep going in that aspect, but I think that they did a really good job of making lemonades out of lemons here.
After they cycle through the dead patches, will they be able to revisit them again?
I'm not sure how long K2 is anticipated to go. I'm not sure if they will be able to revisit those patches. I certainly hope so.
This is not an astronomy question, but your very first slide was an artist's conception of Mira. Who was the artist?
That was Chesley Bonestell. I can go back to it. So Chesley Bonestell did a lot of space art. It's really interesting, the kinds of things he painted. It's a lot easier to see now that it's dimmer in here. His name is up here. So a lot of this is what the future looked like in 1950. Yes.
Does that system likely turn into a type 1A supernova?
Let's see. So this system, we know we have a white dwarf, and we know we have a bloated red giant, which is spilling its mass, like its gas streaming from the bloated red giant onto the small, hot, white dwarf. This situation can lead to something called a type 1A supernova, where too much mass builds up on the surface of the white dwarf for what's holding a white dwarf up, what's keeping it up against the squeeze of gravity. So yes, it could. This particular system, I'm not sure if it can, because if the white dwarf is pretty close to that size threshold in the first place, it would be easy to happen. But if it's only about 0.8 solar masses or something, it's not feasible for it to get that much mass.
Is it possible the star could dissipate before it got enough material to go supernova?
Yes, the red dwarf could stop spilling matter onto the white dwarf before the white dwarf goes supernova. That could easily happen because the red giant will reach the point where it'll, as you said, it will dissipate into a planetary nebula. And it's just a race against time, which one happens first. Yes?
You mentioned that there were a bunch of planets that were candidates from the Kepler mission, and that they were just waiting for confirmation. Is there a list of these somewhere where you can go and see which ones are waiting for confirmation and what they expect the next transit to be?
That's an excellent question. So can we go on the website and check out which planets are awaiting confirmation as candidates and when their next transit is going to be? I imagine that would be on the Kepler website. It should be if it's not, but I'm not sure if it is.
It used to be on Planet Hunters before they redesigned the site. An awful lot of stuff got lost.
Okay. Are these the sorts of stars where amateurs with large aperture scopes from Earth could do confirmation type observations?
So great question. Could you do it with a large amateur telescope at home? I have not heard about that, whether these stars are too faint to do that or not. Kepler isn't that big a telescope. It's just it's in space, which really helps.
Right.
Right. And these transits are so small that being in space really helps because you cut away a lot of the noise that you get from the atmosphere. So I'm not sure. That's an excellent question.
Okay. Yeah, you didn't mention this, but I understand that Kepler information and discovery of all the planets has transformed SETI and given it a new mission, new purpose to go after some of these targets to look for life.
Right. So you're bringing up that SETI, the Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence, kind of had a lapse for a while, but now it's got a new sort of mission, like looking for signs of life from some of these planets. So of course, when we find a potentially habitable planet, it makes sense to point your radio dish at it. Why not, right? If it's plausible that these planets are pretty far away, but it makes sense to look. I agree. Yes?
I know SETI for a while was only listening. Is it sending anything?
Is SETI sending anything right now? Not that I've heard it for a while, although I mean, we're doing radar surveys of things like Venus, so we're sending nearby in that sense, and we're passively sending. But I've not heard of SETI sending an intentional message to a system for quite a long time. Has anyone else?
I thought it was just the initial message.
Right. So mm-hmm.
Weird coded.
And we're sending messages in television signal and video.
Right, but that's not focused and it's not a. Right.
Yeah.
Well, maybe we should. Although. We could probably wait a few years and find out a lot more without, and it would take so long for the signal to get there that waiting a few years probably won't make much difference. Right, yes?
Do you know of anything like a periodic table of the planets such that you sort of describe the parameters on which you base your description and evaluation of newly discovered planets?
So like a periodic table of the planets, sort of like a guide for classifying a newly discovered planet, is that what you're asking?
Yeah.
So there are a couple. One guide is the exoplanet encyclopedia. So that you can use that to search how many planets have been found recently using different methods. How you would define, for example, a super Earth, I think those terms are still pretty vague. I think it's often up to the discussion.
Robin already had all that down. We're just wondering where each one goes on the map. You
know, right.
Is that a class N?
Have right. We started using class N at all?
Class what?
Class M, Star Trek.
I'm more Star Wars than Star Trek, I have to admit.
You do have a class M planets. I mean,
but stars.
Stars.
Right.
All right, as we turn her loose, I do have one announcement before you all leave the room, please.
Go ahead.
Yeah.
Oh, I was just going to say, I think it's time to thank Genevieve. And she has some time, but I think the voice probably needs a break. She's lost a lot.
Oh, okay. Thank you.